हेलो। हाँ मनीष जी, आप फोन कर रहे थे? ठीक, गुड मॉर्निंग एवरीबॉडी एंड वेलकम बैक। आई हैड यस्टरडे वन सेशन ऑफ अराउंड 1 आवर। सो द आइडिया नाउ इज दैट आई हैव सर्टेन वेरी एडवांस्ड प्रोसेसेस व्हिच आई वुड लाइक टू शो इट टू यू। मे बी आई विल टेक अनदर 10 मिनट्स और 15 मिनट्स एंड आफ्टर दैट आई विल हैंड ओवर टू माई PhD स्कॉलर, वेरी सीनियर स्कॉलर। ही इज लाइकली टू सबमिट सून, सो ही हैज वर्कड इन दैट एरिया ओनली। So he'll demonstrate you with a number of softwares and also the printers, like the 3D printing machines which we have in our lab. So that he's likely to show it to you. So with this, I'm starting. I'll share my screen now and I'll start the lecture. Okay. So Jaswinder, are you there in the meeting?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir, I'm in the meeting.
Yeah. Okay. So let me share. So I think my screen has been shared. So let me talk about some advanced, very advanced additive manufacturing processes. So let us have the discussion now. So I'll try to talk about at least 8 processes today. And in a very brief, so they are self-explanatory. So we can start one by one. So this direct energy deposition that I have already talked yesterday. So it is very much similar to LENS process, laser engineered net shaping process, which we have seen yesterday. So basically there are channels like this, and in these channels you are getting the powder. So powder is coming in, and then from the center there's a laser, and you have basically XY control platform. So once this powder comes out and the laser is focused here. So basically there's a melting of this powder and you are able to deposit the material on the entire thing. And this whole thing is done in the infrared, is observed using infrared camera. It is done in inert gas atmosphere. So this is the focal plane, this is the melt pool, and this is how you are going to deposit the material, correct? So I believe that this is clear to all of you. So we have certain, like, it consists of coaxial nozzle mounted on multi-axial arm. Nozzle can have tilting mechanism with Z-axis movement. So that we have already seen yesterday. Material is melted upon deposition with a laser or electron beam also, like. So this video we have seen yesterday. You can just have a look once again. So there's a tilting platform also. The platform has been tilted. Okay, so this is about this thing, and this is just a concept, a virtual simulation, you can say, of the DED process. So through virtual simulation also you can understand. It means the system may be reverse also, like the nozzle may be moving and you can have the platform stationary. That kind of system may also be there. So then we have certain pros and cons also. So suitable for fabricating multi-gradient materials, large size components, and high performance coatings can also be deposited. Fast build and rapid material deposition is there. Fully dense parts, no need for support structures because you are using, you know, a robotic platform, and can be used for repairing work also. Because sometimes you have some worn component, so you can deposit the material there. Then the problems are, like, disadvantages are, like, you have poor surface quality, significant post-processing is required, and part complexity is also limited. So basically you are having different domains in which this process can be applied. So you can just have a look that you have various domains in which the process can be applied. So these are the two references from where this material has been taken. Then LMD is also a similar process, correct? So in LMD, it is a similar process. You can just have a look. Different people have developed it at different places. So because of the IPR purpose, there are different names which have been given, but it is almost similar. Okay, Then we have electron beam additive manufacturing. So in electron beam additive manufacturing, it has basically this thing. It is a powder based bed process also. So here it has been shown that it is a powder bed based process. So there's a powder bed like SLM. Instead of having laser beam, you are having the electron beam gun that generates a high energy beam up to 3000 watt. So instead of having laser, you are having an electron beam. So what do you get? You get better accuracy basically. The beam melts each layer of powder melt to desired geometry. It is a vacuum based process. It eliminates impurities and there is a very good, yields excellent mechanical properties. Then you may also have another version, another variant of the same process. Instead of having the powder, you can have the wire, correct? So this is the wire. So there's a wire and there's an electron beam gun. So there's a molten alloy puddle and there's a previous deposit on the substrate. So you're able to, deposit the material layer by layer. So this is a powder based version of electron beam additive manufacturing. Then similarly, we have like some advantages and limitations. So one advantage is there's a fully dense functionally metallic components you can make, and you can make very fine, features, extensive fine features due to increased penetration depth and rapid scanning speeds. It can efficiently assist developments and modifications of products, especially for complex, difficult to fabricate components. At high process temperature gives low residual stresses and eliminates need for heat treatment after build. EBAM still has deficiencies such as process stability, part defects, and quality variations are definitely there. So there are applications, you can see several applications have been mentioned here. Like there are biomedical applications. I have already showed you yesterday a few biomedical components which have been made by EBAM. And then we also have this engine blades in aerospace applications that have been done. But otherwise, also you have various applications in turbine, oil, gas, nuclear, refractory, ballistic, medical equipment, cladding, and then industrial pump components, power generation, semiconductors, cooling, repair and reconditioning, marine propulsion. Then these are the acknowledgments for this. Then there's a VAM process. This is actually becoming quite popular nowadays. This is called wire arc additive manufacturing. So this is how you can understand that it is actually a welding process, but it is being numerically controlled. So you are able to deposit the material the way you can see in this video, right? So there may be pulses, there may be continuous deposition. So it is a variant of basically direct energy deposition process, we can say. It uses an arc welding process to 3D print metal parts. Process is controlled by a robotic arm. So you can understand the process by this video. Okay. So this is another example. You can see that how the process works. Please mute your video. Please mute your audio. Sometimes I'm getting some voices here. Okay, then we have like there are certain benefits. So wide range of deposition rates are there. Net near net shape you can produce with reduced material loss. Conventional machining time reduced to minimum. There are reduced lead times, good structural integrity, and low to medium complexity of components you can have. But the problems are that there's a lot of residual stresses and distortions. They're similar to the problems which we have in welding. So you can see this picture here on the right that explains you. Then shielding gases are required in certain cases when the material is like titanium. the resolution of the process is low. That's why sometimes you need to do machining or finishing processes to improve the surface quality or to make it a workable solution. These are some examples of wire arc additive manufacturing process. So you can just have a look on various components which have been printed by wire arc additive manufacturing. Even this complete bicycle have been printed by this aluminium material, aluminium alloy, of course, with this worm. Okay, then we have multi-jet fusion printing technology. This is a very advanced, I'll say, and very one of the latest printer we have, that is called HP printer. It is by HP, Hewlett Packard. This printer actually works on the principle, it is for polymeric material. So you can see that there are two recorder kind of things. One is for spreading powder, and maybe two chemicals are applied. One is called developer. There are two agents. One is called detailing agent and another is called fusing agent. So these two agents are deposited. So it is a binder jetting kind of thing actually. Correct? You can see on this second figure, there are two nozzles. So one is for detailing agent application, another is for detailing and a fusing agent. And there is some application of some sort of lamp is also there. So it is a combination of, you know, two, three kinds of processes, but its accuracy and resolution is very high. And you can have very flexible materials like thermoplastic polyurethane materials. And you can also have high density, low porosity components, very high strength components, like polyamide. So basically different kinds of components which have been produced by this printer has been shown in this picture. You can appreciate the quality and the complexity which one can achieve using this printer. Then there's another advanced process which is called DLP, Digital Light Projector 3D Printing, DLP. So in DLP, the principle has been demonstrated DLP by this video.
Use a light projector, similar to what you would find in a movie theater, to project the image of an entire layer simultaneously, regardless of the number of parts. Because they cure a full layer in a single flash, DLP printers can be outstandingly fast. They are also very reliable, with low complexity and no moving.
Okay. So basically in this process, you are having a digital, this is a DLP, is a digital technology. So basically this particular panel, you can see it is having pixels, and these pixels are being illuminated by some digital control, and you have basically UV lamp based projector. So in one go, actually the complete layer is being exposed and you are using the similar kind of material as we use in stereolithography. So we are using a photosensitive polymer, or is a photopolymerization which occurs in this process also. And it uses a more conventional light source and a digital projector screen to flash a single image of each layer across the entire platform at once. So what happens is, like, this is a comparison of stereolithography and DLP. So in stereolithography, you can see that there's a one laser spot and the laser spots keep moving. But in case of DLP, the complete layer is exposed to the light or the UV light in one go. So that's how it makes the process faster. But of course, the detailing may be a limitation. So if you want to really compare the two processes accuracy wise and resolution wise, there are always a competition between the two. Correct? So these are various applications for a DLP process which I have tried to show it to you. So you can just appreciate there's an artificial limb, there's a detoxification device, there's a dental implant, vascularized lung tissue, pharmacy tablets, hearing aids, and jewelry. So these are the designs only. The material is always a problem, you know. Material, these are made of only the this photopolymeric material. But in real time for biomedical applications, you have to have some other materials which are biomaterials. So these are some acknowledgements for this. Then this is the last thing which I would like to tell you. This is called two-photon polymerization 3D printing. So here, this particular process is actually a very complex process, and the physics is very difficult to understand. But in a very simple way, if I want to explain to you, that we are actually using a conical laser convergence like this. So once they in this conical laser, once you are having, you know, this intensity like this, only in a very small volume here, you can see that a voxel, that is there where the polymerization will take place. So it is again based on the some resin which can be polymerized using some laser, and but the resolution is very, very high. Like you can have very small size voxel that can be deposited, which is of the order of 100 nanometer or so. So this particular process is used to deposit many typical biomedical components. So the advantages are like high resolution complementary to two photon microscopy, online process observation is there, polymerization is in the presence of biological tissue and cells is also possible. Because what happens is that in this case, the size of the voxel is so small that it is smaller than the biological tissues and cells. Then the challenges are that you need biocompatible initiators, reactive water-based system, it is there, and monomer with low toxicity you need so that you can develop various biological applications with this particular process. So it has number of applications you can see, which includes from tissue engineering to metamaterials to plasmotics to microelectronics, MEMS, photonics. So these are various areas in which we have the application of TPP process, this two-photon polymerization process. So these are some applications you can see. These are the applications in micro optics domain. So you just try to understand the size of the component. This dimension is 60 micron. So this width of this prism is less than 60 micron, correct? And this is a 23 micron distance. So you can understand that how fine a detailing is there in this particular component. The scaffold is there. You can see that what is the size of these spores which have been developed using this particular process. So there's a scaffold for cell biology. There are a number of applications. I'll show a few more applications. This is a micro needle for drug delivery. So you can just have a look on these micro needles. You can have a feel of the size and you can feel of the features and the holes which are present in this particular device. So this is only, we have the potential of, you know, this kind of process. So this is, then we have another printer which can be, which is being used to deposit the composite materials, correct? So we are depositing composite materials like this. This is a Markforged printer. It is, the process is similar to fused filament deposition, but we can have the fiber spool as well as nylon spool. So there are two spools using which we are able to deposit the composite material. There's a dual nozzle printed. There's a fused filament fabrication and continuous fiber fabrication. It supports, provide the primary filament with loose structures. Nozzle one prints filament of nylon or onyx, and nozzle two prints continuous carbon fiber as the reinforcement. So composites can be made. You can see that there are different, you know, patented material which come with this printer. Onyx, nylon, carbon fiber, fiberglass, Kevlar, and HSHT fiberglass. So these are some machine specifications. These are properties of various materials which come along with this printer. And this is again a matrix of, you know, various machines and the compatible materials. But you have to understand the advantages and limitations. So it is a composite 3D printing, and heating of bed is not required, unlike other FDM processes. Printing can be paused and again progressed from the same level. Separate sealed container is required for filament to avoid humidity. Flexible materials are limited in this case. the company is not based on an open source. That is another problem. So that's why the printer is quite costly printer. So you can see the kind of, you know, accuracy and the kind of strengths which you are getting using this kind of printer. So three examples have been shown. There's a shock absorber, there's a soft jaw for holding purpose in machining, and there's a carburetor which has been printed by this Markforged 3D printer. So this is something which I wanted to tell you in this presentation. So thank you very much. If you have any question, you can discuss with me, and then I'll hand over this talk to my student, Jaswinder. Yeah. So are there any questions? So I can take those questions. Okay, so I think people have understood everything, correct? So it's fine. I think I am handing over to Jaswinder now, because he will be having, I think, 20 around 30 minutes he's having, so that he can discuss about the various printers and maybe little bit about the software. So over to you, Jaswinder. Please carry on now.
Okay, sir.
Yeah.
Is it visible to all?
Yeah.
Okay. Good morning to all of you. Today we will discuss about the 3D printers which we are having in the Rapid Prototyping Lab in IIT Delhi. My name is Jaswinder Singh. As we know that additive manufacturing is the process of joining material, or you can say fabricating the final parts by layer deposition of the material, so that a final shape can be fabricated into the real form from a CAD model. So it is also named as a additive manufacturing, in which a CAD model is fabricated, or you can say designed into a CAD in a CAD software, from where we can we have to save this CAD model into the STL format. STL is the tessellated form of tessellated format, and after generating the STL file, we have to make a layer by layer information by slicing the part into the number of layers. So this is the main part, or you can say the main properties which we can impart in our part by the help of different printing parameters. These are done in the slicing module, you can say in the third step. So here the information regarding the layer thickness, printing speed, and other parameters can be given here, so that the part can be fabricated according to that conditions. After that, the slice part is saved into the G code format, or you can say in a format that can be read by the printers. This slice for file is further imported to the 3D printer, where the printing is being done. You can see in the step 4, the actual fabrication of part is done from this number step 1 CAD model. After printing the final part, in the step 5, we have to do the some of the finishing process if we require, because in some of the 3D printers, there is a need to do the post-processing, or in some in another kind of the printer, we need not any final finishing process. So in our lab, in our IIT Delhi, we generally classify our 3D printer in the three classification on the basis of the material being used. Actually, we have the three kinds of the material which can be printed in our lab by the help of different 3D printers. First one is the liquid material. This material is fabricated into the final shape by the help of polymerization, which is being used into the stereolithography machine, SLA. Next material, or you can say next classification, is done on the basis of the material, solid material, in which the a solid material in the form of wire spool is being used for 3D printing the parts. In this, the material is hot melted and extruded through the nozzle and deposited on the bed, you can say printing bed. In the third classification, we have the powder based material, which is being used in the SLS, selective laser sintering 3D printer, in which the powder, polymer powder is being sintered to form a final shape into the 3D form. So this is the first kind of the printer which we are having. It is actually a base model of the fused deposition molding machine. The basic technology of this printer is the fusion of the filament which is being melted and extruded to the nozzle and deposited on the bed. You can see on the screen that this is a bed on which the material will be printed. So this printer is a classification of the solid base material in which the filament spool is used. A filament spool having the wire shape filament which having the diameter of 1.75 mm. In this, the build volume, or you can say the maximum part size which we can be which we can print in this printer is the 230 mm cube. However, the overall printer dimensions are more 410 and 560 mm cube. This printer has the outer casing which helps in the protecting the part during printing and even after the printing. The basic materials which can be printed in this printer are ABS, that is acrylonitrile butadiene styrene. Second one is the PLA, polylactic acid. Third one is the HIPS, that is high intensity polystyrene. In this, ABS and PLA are the main materials. And second one is the HIPS is the support materials. Support materials, as you know, that for making any cavity or overhang portion in the 3D printing, we need to supply the support so that the part or cavity can be fabricated easily, or there should not be any buckling or any bending or any distortion in the part. So in every kind of the 3D printer, we need to supply some of the support, which can be of the main material, which can be of the secondary material. That that is, like in this, we have the secondary material HIPS as a support material. However, another materials, nylon, PC, HDPE, all these materials can be printed in this printer. As I have already told you that the filament diameter is 1.75 mm. That is the standard diameter. We cannot reduce the diameter below this because the extrusion will not be efficient during the printer. The number of extruders in this printers are the two, in which right one, you can say extruder number one is the main material extruder, and the extruder number two, that is the left extruder, this is the secondary extruder. In the secondary extruder, we need to supply the support material for making any cavity portion, for making any cavity in the part. So minimum, the nozzle bore which we are using in this having the diameter of 0.4 mm, or we can also have another unit of 0.2 mm, that depends upon the requirement which we need. The minimum layer resolution in this is the 100 microns. So the part accuracy will depends directly upon the laser resolution, layer resolution. So it has a less resolution as compared to the other printers which we are having. The maximum extrusion temperature have the 500 degrees Celsius, and another option is the 300 degrees Celsius. However, for our materials, these can be varied accordingly. As in our lab, we are having the ABS material, so for that material we are we have set the material up to the 230 degrees Celsius for printing. In this, the build platform is the heated type, so reduce in the to reduce the thermal gradient or temperature gradient, we need to supply the heat to the printing bed. So we are using here a heated type printing bed which have the temperature of 100 degrees Celsius according to the material which which will be used for printing. Another support material, as this has a feature of the material can be used for the support in this printer. However, we can also use the dual color printing. As you have already seen that the printer has the two extruders. So In case of we need to print the parts of different colors, so in that case we can remove the support material and supply the main material of different color in the second extrusion, and we can program our part accordingly that part will be printed in the dual color mode. So we can also have the multi-material printing facility in this, because a number of extruder can be varied. So basic features, so you can say the highlights of the printer, Sada did have the dual color, dual extruders as main material extruder and the support material extruder. However, build volume is the 9-inch cube, and it is capable of low printing with the low moving marks. That is, only the extruder are being moved during printing. Remaining parts are stationary, and it has the facility of print protect. That is, during printing, you are looking on the screen that it has a closed chamber. So during printing, the part will be printed and part will be enclosed in this chamber. So if you have given a command of printing and you have to do some work somewhere else, so you can leave the part without any danger. You can see how the FDM will work during printing by this video. Okay, so this video already explained that how the printer will work, and you can see these are the parts which have been fabricated in IIT Delhi. You can see the very complex shape can be easily fabricated by using the FDM base, or you can say solid base material. Next, this is the stereolithographic. You can say it has a short name as SLA. It is the liquid based material printer. That is, the material being used is in the liquid monomer unit, the monomer form. Actually, why I am saying it has a monomer, because when this material is exposed to the laser, it gets polymerized and form into the solid form. So the printing is done by the polymerization process. In this we are having the laser spot which will come from the downward side to the upper side, because this printer has a inverted kind of the printing bed, or you can say printing platform. In this why we are using the inverted platform, because the material is in the liquid form, so the material which is unconditioned, or you can say unpolymerized, will get down by the effect of gravity, and waste of the material will be very, very less in this kind of the printer. So minimum layer XY resolution of this printer is at 25 microns, and minimum layer spot is the 85 micron. So as the laser spot is having the very small size, that is 85 microns, so we can also get a very good resolution in this kind of the printer. So In this, the laser power is being used of 250 megawatt milliwatt laser. Build volume in this printer is the 14.5 and 18.5 centimeter. So in the previous printer, that was the 230 mm. So the build size, you can see the print bed is very small as compared to the FDM based printer, but the accuracy of the printer is very high because the layer thickness can be varied from 25 microns to 300 microns. So as the layer resolution is getting down, so printing accuracy is more. So the in the FDM you have seen that there was a layer thickness of 100 microns, but in this we have minimum 25 microns. So it has a good part accuracy, and resin or you can say raw material is being used in the form of liquid stage. So we have to fill that material into a cartridge, and number of cartridges which can be used here in the number one. That printing cartridge can be attached into the printer at the backside. You can see this black panel is showing the cartridge where the cartridge has been attached. The operating temperature of this printer is 35 degrees Celsius. That is it also has the facility of auto heat, because for printing for starting the printing we need to maintain a temperature of 35 degrees. So in this we have the auto heat feature that the printing will not be started till the temperature is not achieved up to the 35 degrees Celsius. Input files. In this printer, we have the two kinds of the format can be used for printing, as shown here, that one is the STL file and another one is the OBJ file. The basic feature, this has a one-click print that we need to press only a button for printing. We need not to import the part to the printer. We just in this printer system, you can say a desktop is attached to the printer, and one command can be given to the printer to print any part. So it has the adaptive layer thickness, as you have seen that it has a range of the layer thickness of 25 to 300 microns. It can be used as a remote print because we can give the printing command by using the Wi-Fi mode. It has the auto orient, auto mesh repair, and auto generation of support feature that according to the part shape, it can set the printing spot or meshing according to the requirement. Also, we can also provide the support or mesh or you can say orientation according to our requirement by manual settings. Further, the software of the machine has the facility of rotating, scaling, integrating the part. So we can by this we can print the number of parts of same design at one time. You can see how this printer can work for fabricate any part. Thank you. Okay, you can see here, these are the parts which have been fabricated in IIT Delhi. You can see how accurate the parts and how the how much complexity which can be fabricated in the SLA. Next is the printer which is classified as a powder based material printer. You can see a selective laser sintering printer. In this, the polymer powder is being used for the printing purposes. The basic principle of this printer is the sintering of the powder particles together so that a final solid shape can be formed by the sintering principle. The maximum printing volume of this printer is 150 mm cube. So the part accuracy generally depends on the materials which will be used for printing. As you can see on the screen, that the printing accuracy for the PA12. PA12 is the patented material which is being supplied by the company. So for this printing accuracy is the 90 into 130 mm cube. But for the material of Hexa TP, it has the more part size, or you can say more printing volume as compared to the previous one. So from these parameters, we can judge that the printing accuracy is also a factor of polymeric factor of the materials which will be used for the printing. In this, the printing speed can be reached up to 10 mm per hour. So it is a very low printing speed. Part time will be, build time will be more for this printer. The layer height in this printer is 0.0775 mm to 0.175 mm. That is, this is more as compared to the SLA based printer, but it is less in comparison to the FDM based printer. So the part accuracy for this printer will be the mediator of the two printers, as I have already discussed that FDM and SLA based printer. In this, the minimum wall thickness can be attained is 0.4 mm and detail size is 0.1 mm. However, the maximum temperature in the chamber which can be attained is the 190 degrees Celsius. So this is the limitation, you can say, of this printer. So we need to select a powder particles, polymer powder particles according to that condition, that the materials, you can say, of powder which can be sintered at this temperature can be used for printing purposes. And particle size of the powder is in the range of 200 micron to 400 micron in the PA12 material. And however, generally the particle size in the powder diameter for material can be attained up to 2200 microns. The powder capacity, the maximum in filling is can be done up to the 6 liter. The salient feature of the SLS is the parts can be used for the functional testing purposes. So this is a very good rapid prototyping technique for validating any prototype. The printing speed is very low, so this has a low volume manufacturing. However, the parts which can be which will be used for the high heat application can be fabricated in this printer. The accuracy is up to the 0.05 mm layer thickness. It also has the Wi-Fi connectivity, so we can do the remote printing by using the Wi-Fi connectivity. However, the particle size is very, very small, so we need to take care during the printing. So we need to wear the aprons and gloves and other things for safety purposes. The working of the SLS you can see in this video. Okay, these are the examples of the SLS parts which have been fabricated in IIT Delhi. You can see here, any kind of the shape can be fabricated. But in this, the support material is same as the main material because powder is self-acting as a support material for printing any cavity or overhang portion. Next is the BioBoard 3D printer. Actually, in IIT Delhi, we also have a bioprinter, or we are also working on the some bio implants for medical applications or for tissue engineering applications. So in this, we are using the BioBoard 3D printer. In this, the extruder are being used in the number of two, in two numbers. You can see on the screen that there are two extruders. The first one, you can say left one is the main extruder and secondary, right one is the secondary extruder. In this, the two extruder can be used as a one as a main material and another as a support material. However, in this printer, we have a facility of printing any kind of the material which is biocompatible or bio degradable materials. In the main material, we have the heating arrangement, so any kind of the bio compatible polymer can be printed with the direct solid foam because heating is available in this. In the secondary extruder, we have the facility to attach the live cells. We can fill here the drugs or medicines for loading into the implant. We also can use the natural polymers in conjunction with the synthetic polymer in the extruder one for printing a composite part of natural and synthetic polymers. So these features of this printer facilitates us to fabricate any kind of the construct which can be used for medical purposes. The however, the extrusion of the material in this printer is being done by the help of the air pressure, so which can be attained up to 100 psi. In this, we have a compressed air chamber which is being attached here at the backside of the printer to supply the air pressure. The maximum temperature can be attained is the 160 degrees Celsius. So this is the limit of this printer, because if we attain the higher temperature, there may be some damage to the tissues or maybe degradation of the drugs. So this is the limitation which is necessary for printing any bio implants. This also has the facility of photo curing. In some kind of the natural polymers, if we have to make them hard and solid, you can say rigid, to change them into a rigid form, we need to UV cure that part. So in the secondary extruder, we have the facility of UV curing, photo curing purposes by the LED of 409 nanometer. In this, the photo curing can be set manually, or by we can also automatically photo cure by programming the part. And the build volume in this printer is the 19 to 16 to 130 mm, which is very small as compared to the previous printer, but this is sufficient for any medical implant, medical tissue. The support material, you can say build players. Generally, in this printer, the part is not printed on this bed. We need to put some of the players or dishes to print the part. You will see in the next video how the printing is being done in this printer. The support build players which are being used here are the sliders, petrifications, valve players. The material used for this printer are the natural polymers, or you can say composition of natural and synthetic polymer, that is gelatin, methacrylate, synthetic polymers, biocompatible polymers are PCL, PLGA. These are the synthetic polymers, but biocompatible. Hyperelastic bonds materials, fibroblast and mesenchymal stem cells. These are the live cells which can be print in the tissue construct by this printer. This is a very, very good printer for any kind of the bio implant fabrication. We can fabricate any artificial tissue, artificial limb. You, for example, ear. We can also form a construct that is a bone scaffold for tissue engineering application, because it has a very small footprint, that is the size of the printer is very small, can be fit into the biosafety hood. It is very accessible, easy to upload design and plugins. However, visible light technology is used in this, which can be used for storing any of the medical implant to kill any of the bacteria virus on the implant. Further, dual extruder can facilitate the medical loading, like drugs and medicine loadings, or you can say the tissue or cell loading also. It is a open system kind of printer, because we are using here the two kinds of the 10 ml BD syringes in both of the extruders. The precision of this printer is the 10 microns. So accuracy of the printer is very, very much high. You can see here the printing is not being done on the platform. It is being done into the petri dish, because during the bio printing purposes, we need to take care of the safety, that the parts should not be get toxified by the external bacterial or viruses on the bed. So we need to sterilize the petri dish and then we start printing on the petri dish. These are the examples of the parts which have been fabricated. This is first one you can see. This is a bone tissue scaffold which have been fabricated in IIT Delhi in RP lab. So this is another example which have been fabricated by this printer. Another printer is the carbon fiber, continuous carbon fiber 3D printed. This sir has been already told you. This is the Mark Forge printer which uses the carbon fiber filament in conjunction with the main filament fiber. So in this, the printing part can have a good strength as compared to the previous FDM based printer, because the carbon fiber filament is being used for importing for reinforcement of the carbon fibers into the main part. You can see here, this is the small spool which is having a carbon fiber spool, carbon fiber filament coiled over this spool. And this is the part which have been fabricated by using the main filament and the carbon fiber filaments. So build volume in this printer is the 320 into 132 and 154 mm. In this, the basic feature is, you can say one of the advantage of this printer is that it is a auto. It has the facility of auto setting, that is the level of the bed can be auto arranged by the printer. We need not to do the manual setting of the printing bed. Further, extruder are two in the two number, in which one extruder is the main material, you can say nylon material printer, or another one is the fiber printer, fiber extruder, in which we are extruding the carbon fiber filament. Layer height is similar to the previous one, that is 100 micrometer, as we have seen in the earlier FDM based printer. So accuracy of both of the printer is same, but in this part can be printed with the reinforcement of the fiber of various kind, like carbon fibers, fiberglass, Kevlar, and high strength, high temperature fiberglass fibers can be used in this printer. The main material are the onyx nylon wire. These are the patented material which are being supplied by the company. And the basic technology of this printer is same to the FDM based printer. These are the basic features, high strength printing, number of materials can be printed here, good precision in the, and it has a Eiger printing software, that is a cloud based system. So we need not to do any installation of the software. This is the basic printing principle of this printer. Okay, these are the parts which have been fabricated by this printer, you can see. Okay, thank you. This was from my side. Any questions from the audience? No, sir. In SLA, we need to supply a liquid cartridge material. Also, which we are having in our lab, only single cartridge is being used. So that material will be poured into the container where the material is being supplied for printing purposes. Someone is asking that is SLA printer need supports? Hello? Yes. In SLA, actually the main material is self-acting as a support material because during printing, the bed will be down up to the height of one layer thickness. So at that point, only the portion which is designed into the CAD model will be, you can say, as a support, act as a main material. Remaining liquid material will be untouched, will act as a support material. Did you understand? Yes. We have actually one question is asking by some of the candidates being asked by it that the part size that is 5 meter and 3 meter, right? The part size of 5 into 3 meter square. Okay, this depend upon the printer size. So we have some kinds of the big size printers in the market which can print that size kind of the part also. So for that, we need to use the printer of that much of the printing bed. These are also available in the market. Even the printer also available, which can also build the full room by using the concrete mixture. Yes, someone is asking that we can use the 3D printing in education. Yes, we can use the 3D printing in education. We have the number of applications for the 3D printing. You can say we, as in the internship, some of the students are coming in IIT Delhi. They need to do some of the prototyping practices. So we can do here also. Someone is asking that can be used for the 4D. Yes, I have seen some of the application and number of the research papers are coming in the recent time that the 4D printing is being done by the help of the 3D printing. That depends upon your fourth dimension, which we are, you are using. That most in most of the research papers, the fourth dimension is the time dependent. So all these factors can be employed in the 3D printer. without extruder, no one can use the FDM, because extruder is the main part from which the filament is being extruded. Actually, extruder has a nozzle attached at the end point of the extruder, from which the material which is being heated or melted is extruded through the nozzle tip, and that material is deposited on the bed, as you have seen in the video. So without extruder, we cannot make any FDM based printer. Actually, which material cannot be printed? That is the point of you can say exploration. You can explore in the research papers. We have the number of the materials, and some of the researchers also doing the printing of the materials which have been not being printed by the conventional printers. So I think research is still going on. There was some another question which was asking about. Someone is asking that we can use the metallic powder. The metallic powder is already being printed by the SLS based system, that is named as a SLM, selective laser melting. Some of the industries also using the metallic powder for making any metallic part by using the 3D printing, the printer name SLM. Sir, this is the IIT Delhi procedure. So you need to read the prospectus, so you can go through the IIT website for getting the internship. This is not a lab concern. This is being done by the IIT Delhi. Yes. Thank you, sir. Yes, thank you, sir. Okay. Thank you, sir. Okay, sir, I am leaving now. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Yeah, good morning, Manish ji. I have logged in using two devices. Actually, my headphone was not working with laptop, so I have used my mobile phone for audio and for presentation. I will be using my laptop. Okay. I hope it is not disturbing, right? Yeah. Yes. Thank you, Dr. Manish. I hope I am reachable, I am audible to all of you. And as well as I am sharing my screen so that there is no glitch in between. So I hope my screen is visible. Okay. Yeah. Okay. So good morning, participants. I am supposed to talk on the topic which is assigned to me, that is design for additive manufacturing, that is for 3D printing. Okay, so maybe this is the second day, so you might be knowing, or some person you might feel that it might be repetitive, but I am sure that today's session you are going to add something new which might not be delivered by other expert in this FDP. Okay, so you are aware that additive manufacturing is an appropriate name which describes the technology, okay, in which we build 3D objects. Okay, so how these 3D objects are created? These 3D objects are created by adding layer upon layer of material. Okay, so in the right hand side you can see there is a 3D object which has been created by adding layer upon another layer. Okay, so this way this additive manufacturing or the 3D printing takes place. The material may be plastic, concrete, or in future we are expecting that we will be able to print even human tissues. People are trying, researchers are working that in future that we will be able to print tissues using this technique. Okay, so I will briefly give an overview, and I will define the various processes in a single line. I will try to tell you there are 7 types of additive manufacturing processes. First one is binder jetting. So under binder jetting, the droplet printing of liquid is used to bind powder material together. Then second one is your direct energy deposition, under which the material is simultaneously fed into a moving focused energy region. Third one is your material extrusion. Under material extrusion, the material is fed through a nozzle in a liquid state, after which it solidifies. Okay, then we have material jetting process. So under material jetting, the material is jetted in liquid droplet form, after which it is solidified. Then we have sheet lamination process, Okay, so under seat lamination process, the seats of material are bonded together either before or after the part outline is separated from the seat. Then we have wet polymerization. Okay, so under wet polymerization, a platform is dropped through or raised above a vat of liquid resin where light is used to selectively solidify it. Okay, so these are the major processes among the additive manufacturing processes. These seven processes are well matured nowadays. Okay, so talking about these seven additive manufacturing processes, you know, some steps are common in all additive manufacturing processes. Okay, so what are these steps? These steps are again seven additive manufacturing steps. First one, the first step in any additive manufacturing process is the model design. Okay, so under this, what we do, we take help of any 3D CAD modeling software, and we create 3D model of our desired object. Okay, so in this we can use any 3D CAD modeling software, and using this 3D CAD modeling software, we are able to get STL files. Okay, so this, which is the second step in the case of additive manufacturing process. Okay, so then STL file format, I will not explain much because it will be repeatedly taken up by, or might be already have been taken up by previous speakers. Okay, then third step is the build preparation, that is your STL file is exported into the your build software. Okay, this may be any software like Cura or any other 3D printing software build used for build preparation, particularly used by the printer which is available with you. Okay, so after this build preparation, under this build preparation, what you do, you orient the object as per your requirement. You may rotate it, you may put the object at certain angles or whatever orientation you wish to achieve. Okay, after that this build preparation is completed, your slice data is generated normally in all build preparation software, and after this slice generation of slice data, what is done, this your build process starts. Okay, which is the fourth step in additive manufacturing process. So after this your slice data is ready, you can go for building of your 3D object, and as soon as this building process is completed, you are supposed to remove your 3D object from the platform. Okay, so which is the fifth steps, that is the removal of your part from the platform, as well as certain post processing may be required, like the removal of support structure, etc. Okay, maybe further machining may be required on your 3D object. All this comes under the category of post processing. Okay, then we have a sixth step, that is the quality and inspection. Okay, so because these products are produced using your 3D printer, so there should be a quality check and inspection according to the your desired quality of your product. Okay, so coming to the application, the product specific application as per the requirement of application of your product. So these are the major steps when we are talking about any manufacturing, any additive manufacturing process. So let us move forward. These up to this, I hope the things will be covered by many of the researchers or many of the speakers in multiple times. So I have not elaborated much on these details. I will come to the main topic, that is the design for additive manufacturing. Okay, so as we know from discussion till now, that additive manufacturing has evolved from prototyping to a production technology. Now it is a full-fledged manufacturing process, and it is